As a way of introduction, the book of Ruth is a book of redemption. We're going to see it as a beautiful picture of what our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ has done for us in redeeming us. It's a beautiful picture, Ruth, this young woman, beautiful picture of us, the church, whom the Lord has redeemed. The book of Ruth is a book of hope. And we're going to see a very hopeless situation. Folks, have you ever asked yourself, where's God? Have you ever been in a difficult situation where life is really hard, where there's pain, there's suffering in your life, and you get in your heart, you say, Lord, where are you? Where are you, God, in my situation? God, can you help? The book of Ruth, I love it. A book of hope in hopeless situations. The book of Ruth, by the way, Ruth is one of the great grandmother of Jesus Christ. And so this is an important story because it tells us really kind of some of the genealogy of Jesus. It allows us to understand why Jesus was born in the town of Bethlehem. And we'll get to that at the end of the book of Ruth. But lovely book. This is actually one of my more favorite Old Testament books. So without further ado, let's go ahead and pray and we'll get in the Word, okay? Lord Jesus, thank you so much for your Word. We know, as Megan encouraged us, your Word will never return void. It always goes forth and accomplishes that which you purpose. So I pray, God, that you would purpose for your Word to bear fruit in our life. May, Lord, this not be simply just a Bible study where we're just here to fill up notes in a notebook. Lord, we're here to hear your heart, that your Word would change us, transform us, strengthen us, and encourage us, convict where we need to be convicted, and comfort where we need to be comforted. So I pray, Lord God, you would speak to us clearly, and we would hear, all of us would hear your voice. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Book of Ruth, chapter 1, verse 1 says this. Now it came about in the days when the judges governed. Again, if you don't have a Bible, look at somebody's Bible because we're going to have a Bible study. It came about when the days when the judges governed that there was a famine in the land. And a certain man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the land of Moab with his wife and his two sons. And the name of the man was Elimelech. And the name of his wife, Naomi. And the name of his two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem in Judah. Now they entered the land of Moab, and it says they remained there. Here we have an amazing insight into a period of time known as the period of the judges. And the period of the judges is an interesting time in the history of Israel because it's kind of a cyclical history where the nation of Israel would serve God when they had strong leadership. They had guys like Samson, guys like Gideon, strong women of God, like women like Deborah. They had these leaders, and whenever they had a leader, the people, man, they would walk with God and worship God. But then sadly what would happen is the leader would die or the leader would move on. And the people, because they didn't have strong leadership, they would often fall into sin. And because they would fall into sin, God would allow them to be captured and enslaved in bondage to foreign powers. And then once they were enslaved and in bondage, they would cry out to God. And God would raise up another deliverer. And once God raised up a deliverer, then they'd walk with God over and over and over again. Read through the book of Judges. It's kind of the same story over and over and over again with different people. And that's why, church, the Lord is purposed. The Lord is established for there to be apostles and prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. God is ordained for there to be ministers amongst ministers, priests amongst priests, so that we can all be encouraged and equipped in the ways of God. Now, just so you know, the challenge of what was going on, flip back one page, please. It says the very last verse and the very last chapter of Judges, chapter 21, verse 25. In those days, there was no king in Israel. This was before Solomon, before David, before Saul. There was no king, and everyone did what was right in his own eyes. That's scary. When God's people didn't have any true leadership. And they didn't have a shepherd. They didn't have a king. They didn't have any judges at certain times. And they did what was right in their own eyes. That's a scary place to be, church. That's why it's good. I mean, as a pastor myself, I have pastors that have authority and they speak into my life all the time, like you just saw. Michael, you're rambling. You know, I have, brothers in my life that I'm accountable to. That's healthy to have accountability and to have leadership in God's church. Well, we see in this story, God's people in the town of Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, enter into a famine. Now, we don't know why the famine was. Perhaps the people in that area, perhaps they were in sin. And so because they were in sin, God didn't send rain. That's possible. Perhaps they were in a famine because that's just life. Sometimes it rains, sometimes it doesn't. What's interesting for you Bible scholars, for you guys who are students of the word, does anybody know what the word Bethlehem means? Bethlehem means what? House of bread. Here's God's people. They're living in the house of bread. And the name Judah, who knows what Judah means? Praise. I love it. It means praise. Here's God's people. They're living in the house of bread. They're living in the land of praise. And they go through a famine. You know what? Folks, that can happen to all of us. That can happen to God's people. We can be in the house of bread. We can be in the land of praise, the church. And sometimes there can be a famine for bread, for the manna, for the word of God. There can be a famine. That's a scary place to be. Do you know, actually, statistically, only about 3% of churches do what we're doing right now? That's have a midweek Bible study. Very few churches actually do what we're doing right now. Now, I'm not saying one love is all that, but I'm saying it's a scary time when the church, when there's a famine for the word of God, there's a famine for the manna from heaven. But it's also possible, guys, it's also possible, church, to be in church and be starving, to be hungering for the word of God. If you would, let me read to you the book of Amos. Amos chapter 8, for you note takers, Amos chapter 8, verse 11 says this, "Behold," check it out, "behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine for bread or thirst for water, but rather for hearing the words of the Lord." God's word says there's days coming when there's going to be a famine for God's word, where very few places the word of God is going to be declared. That's why what we talked about in this Sunday, Paul said, Timothy, very last charge, Timothy, preach the what? Preach the word in season and out of season. Preach the word, Timothy, declare the word, herald the word. But it's possible, church. It's possible to be even in church, to even be in a place where the word of God is opened. And have you ever just been in church, in fellowship, and the word of God is open, but you're just kind of starving? You're just not getting nourished? I have. Have you ever, even in your own times where you wake up in the morning and you open the word and you want to have a devotional, have you ever gone through kind of a famine where you open the word and it just seems kind of dry? It just seems like there's a famine, like I'm not really like getting anything out of it. Well, here are God's people living in the house of bread, living in the land of praise in Bethlehem and Judah. They're going through a famine. And the people, the guy, the dad, the father, his name is Elimelech. Elimelech, this dad, what an awesome name. His name means, "My God is King." Could you imagine that? Walking around town, everybody's like, "Hey, my God is King. How's it?" That's your name. "My God is King." And you're walking around, "My God is King." "What's your name?" "My God is King." What an awesome name. Here is this godly man. "My God is King." And his wife, Naomi, her name means pleasantness. Just sunshiny. I actually dated a girl in high school. Her name was Sunshine Beach. Needless to say, her parents were kind of hippies, you know, last name of Beach. They're like, "Let's just call our daughter Sunshine." And it was kind of funny because her name was Sunshine Beach, and she was the most cheerful, like, sunny personality. She was just one of those girls that's just so smiley and happy all the time. I think Naomi was like that. Naomi was just one of those pleasant, sunshiny, always smiley, happy, joyful individuals. But then their children, Mahalon and Chilion. Mahalon, his name can be translated as sick or sickly. So here we have, now back then in the Old Testament, when they named somebody, their names had meaning. So they looked at their little son, here's my God is king, and here's pleasantness, and they have a little son, and he's just kind of like, you know, so they just, let's call him sickly, you know. And then they have another son, and Chilean, his name can be translated as puny. Some translations say pining, which means kind of consumption. He's kind of consuming away. So they have two sons. There's sickly and here's puny. Well, sadly, because of the famine, it says in verse 1 and verse 2, they went to sojourn in Moab, and they actually dwelt. They remained in Moab. Now, for you Bible scholars, we know the beginning of Moab started in Genesis 19. Lot ran away from Sodom, and him and his two daughters ended up in this cave, and his two daughters said, well, there's no men here for us to have husbands. So these two daughters got their daddy drunk and had relations with their daddy, and Moab, the guy Moab, was the product of incest between Lot and his daughter. But Moab's beginning was sexual perversion in a place of darkness. And for you Bible scholars, Psalm 108, God refers to Moab, and he says, Moab is my washpot. Basically, Moab is my garbage can. Some translations would actually say, Moab is my toilet bowl. God says, Moab, this place that began in darkness and perversion, Moab's my garbage can. Moab's my toilet bowl. Oh, church, when we read this and we realize what's going on, here's this godly family, and they turn prodigal. This godly family where the dad, my God is king, and the wife, man, sunshine, pleasant, and there's a famine. They're just kind of hungry. They're in the house of bread, the land of praise, and they're not getting fed, and they make the mistake. They go to the garbage can. They go to the toilet bowl. Church, I wonder how often we do that. We're Christians. God is our king. We have a sunshine, a pleasantness about us. And I wonder how often, you know, we're doing our devotions and we're not really having any powerful devotions. It just seems kind of dry. Or maybe there's seasons in Christian life. You know, there's some seasons where we're just growing hardcore. It's like a summer or a spring season. But we also go through winters. As Christians, we go through dry times. We go through difficult times. Amen? And the challenge is, when we go through difficult times as Christians, when it's not like, yay, I'm saved, but it's just kind of like monotonous, the challenge is that sometimes we think, well, I'm going to go and check out the garbage can of the world. Maybe I'm going to turn on the TV and, you know, check out Moab, a place of darkness, a place of perversion. I'm going to check out something perverted or dark or something that's, you know, it's not Bethlehem, it's not the bread of the Lord, it's not a place of praise, it's not praise, it's not Judah, it's Moab. I'm gonna go and dwell in Moab. I'm gonna hang out there. Oh Lord, protect us from that. I really pray, church, I really pray for us that God would protect us from that. That no matter what season we go through, we would remain in the house of bread, amen? We would remain in the place of praise, amen? I pray all of us, regardless of whether we're in a time of famine or a time of feasting, that we would stay in the house of the Lord. Well, this family, unfortunately, they didn't do that. And they brought their sons sick and puny. And then look at verse 3, church. Look at verse 3. Then Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. That's always what happens. Church, that's always what happens when we leave the house of bread, the land of praise, when we go to the toilet bowl of this world, when we go to the garbage can of the devil. That's always what happens to us. God no longer is king. Because I can't say God is my king when I'm going to the garbage can of the world. I can't say my God is king when I'm in the place of darkness and perversion. That's always what happens. Elimelech dies. And now we have pleasantness, and she has her two sons. And then look at verse 4. And they took for themselves, look at the sons. Verse 4. They took for themselves Moabite women as wives. This was never to be done. The Jewish boys, the Jewish girls, they were to marry within the Jewish nation. They weren't to marry outside foreign women because they'd end up possibly worshiping the foreign gods. But the, you know, Mahalon and Chilion, these sick and puny, you know, these little guys, they marry these Moabite women. And the name of one was Orpah. She can be translated Orpah, not Oprah. Orpah can be translated youthful or deer or fawn. Apparently she was fast like a gazelle. I don't know. Maybe she was an athlete. Married Orpah, and the name of the other was Ruth. Ruth can be translated as friendship. She can be translated as fellowship, or she can be, her name, Ruth can be translated as a warm personality. So you have the gazelle, you have deer or fawn, this woman, and then you have personality, friendship, fellowship. But sadly, church, sadly, these two young men of God. Now, I personally wonder why any woman would marry. Imagine, hey, what's your name? I'm sick. Yeah, I want to marry you. You know, hey, what's your name? I'm puny. Yeah, let's marry that guy. I personally wonder why any two women would marry a couple guys that were sick and puny. But I think we're going to see why later on. We're going to see why. But can I just talk to all my moms and my dads real quick? And if you're young and you're not a mom and dad or you're not married yet, and if you ever plan, should the Lord tarry, on getting married and becoming a mom and becoming a dad, can I encourage you, family, as a young father myself, can I encourage you to stay plugged in to the Lord, to stay plugged in to the house of bread, to the land of praise? Here's why. Because sometimes you might be a lover of Jesus. You might be a man whose God is my king, and you might be that woman with that sunshine, warm, pleasant personality from the Lord. But as a youth pastor, I know there's a lot of kids that mom and dad are strong in the Lord, but they haven't found their identity in the Lord yet. And maybe their faith is kind of sick. Maybe their faith is kind of puny. My job, now that's not, there's some kids in our youth group, man, these guys were rocking out on stage. Some of the kids in our youth ministry, man, they're charging for the Lord. That's awesome. But we also have some folks, some children that they're struggling in their walk. Mom, dad, can I encourage you, please, as a youth pastor, can I encourage you, can I beg you, please stay plugged in, because if you go to the toilet bowl, if you go to the garbage can of the world, it can have an effect on the lives of your children. And you know, if you have a son, if you have a daughter, I know your hope is that your son would marry a godly woman and that your daughter would find a righteous man of God that would love her in the ways of the Lord, that they would live for God. But mom, dad, if I fail, to be plugged into Bethlehem, praise, the land of Judah, I can't expect my kids to. Now, God can get a hold of them. God got a hold of me. But don't be surprised if you walk away from the house of bread. Don't be surprised if your kids do as well. If your kids marry unbelievers. If your kids, if they also, they join with the toilet bowl. They join with the garbage can. Amen? You guys hear my heart? Okay, now check it out. Verse 5, then both Mahalon and Chilion also died. Kind of see that one coming, yeah? Sick and puny, they didn't last long. Well, both Mahalon and Chilion also died, and the woman was bereft of her two children and her husband. Oh, dangerous. Verse 6, then she arose and her daughters-in-law that she might return from the land of Moab, for she had heard in the land of Moab that the Lord had visited his people in giving them food. Oh, family, that's always how it is. You know, we go through dry times and we think, well, maybe something out there in the world will satisfy. And we go to the garbage can of the world, and the whole time the very thing that we were longing for is still in the land of praise and the house of bread. If she would have just stayed there, if she would have just waited there, bread would have come. They wouldn't have had to go through the trials. For you note takers, the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31 says, yet those who wait on the Lord will gain new strength. They will mount up with wings like eagles. They will run and not get tired. They will walk and not become faint. Church, wait on the Lord. Amen? Whatever you go through, whatever we go through in our seasons of life, wait on the Lord. Remain in the house of bread. Remain in the land of praise. Stay plugged in, church. Stay plugged in to the Lord. Well, she heard that the Lord had visited his people. Verse 7, look what it says. So she departed from the place where she was and her two daughters-in-law with her, and they went on the way to return to the land of Judah. And Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, verse 8, go return each of you to her mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. May the Lord, verse 9, grant that you may find rest each in the house of her husband. Then she kissed them and they lifted up their voices and wept. She's saying, girls, go back to your own community. If you come with me, if you go back with me to Bethlehem, if you go back with me to Judah, you know, my people are commanded not to intermarry other nations. And so if you go back with me, girls, you're not going to find husbands. You're going to be a widow for the rest of your life. Girls, imagine being 18, 19, 20 and knowing that, man, what if you're never going to get married? So here's Naomi saying, girls, just go back to your own communities. Go back and, you know, get married. And then they have this is what I imagine all women Bible studies are like, or women groups. You know, they're all hugging and crying and stuff, you know. Sorry. By the way, you know, hey, this is Naomi, the older Christian gal, just telling the younger Christian gals how it is. And if you're a younger Christian gal, you know, I hope you can find an older Christian gal that, as Titus chapter 2 talks about, Titus 2 says, older women, encourage the younger women how to live life, how to be godly wives. And younger women, you know, look up to these older gals who have raised their families and walked in the ways of the Lord. And so Naomi's like, hey, girls, here's the situation. And she's going to lay it out in more detail. Check it out, verse 10. And then they said to her, no, but we will surely return with you to your people. But Naomi said, return, my daughters. Why should you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may be your husbands? Return, my daughters, go, for I am too old to have a husband. And if I said I have hope, if I should even have a husband tonight and also bear sons, would you therefore wait until they were grown? Would you therefore refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, for it is harder for me than for you, for the hand of the Lord has gone against me. Now, if you're wondering, church, what this is all about, Old Testament days for the nation of Israel, for you Bible scholars, Deuteronomy chapter 25. Deuteronomy 25, when you were a man and you married a woman, if you died, your brother had the privilege of marrying your wife. And then he got to have children with your wife, and the first son would take your name. So imagine, we got like Paul and Wally over here. So imagine like Wally, he marries this, you know, gal. You can be bet Paul's going to be really like checking her out, because Wally dies, Paul's got to marry her. And then, you know, whatever children Paul has with Wally's wife, or because Wally's dead, you know, then the first son, we're going to name the first son Wally. You know, and so Ruth's like, you know, girls, you know, even if I had a husband tonight, you wouldn't wait around for my little baby boy to, you know, go through puberty and become a man. You don't want to be like a cradle robber. You know, you wouldn't be like 40 years old and marry like a 16-year-old boy. You wouldn't do that. So go back to your own country. That's basically what she's saying. Again, the older gal sometimes can tell it like it is. Now, look at verse 14. It says, and they lifted up their voices and they wept again. They're crying. Typical girl study. They wept again. And Orpah, she kissed her mother-in-law. Oh, underline it, circle it, church. But Ruth clung to her. Then she said, behold, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and her gods. Underline it, circle it. Return after your sister-in-law. But Ruth said, do not urge me to leave you or turn back from following you. For where you go, I will go. And where you lodge, I will lodge. And your people will be my people. And your God, underline it, church, your God will be my God. Why do you think Orpah and Ruth, the gazelle and the friendly fellowship girl, why do you think they married sick and puny? Because sick and puny knew God. Sick and puny, Mahalon and Chilion, these were young men who knew the Lord. They knew the God of gods, the King of kings, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And these women thought, wow, these men are special. and they married him. But here's the difference. Listen, there is a difference between true conversion and false conversion. There is a difference between truly being converted to the Lord and being moved emotionally by the Lord. There's a difference. If you would, please, keep your finger here in Ruth very quickly. Turn to the New Testament, 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1 and 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 7. For those of you that are homeschoolers, like Mike over there, that's after 6. Oh, that was a low blow. 2 Corinthians chapter 7 says this. Chapter 7, find me at verse 10. It says, "For the sorrow that is according to the will of God produces a repentance without regret, leading to salvation. But the sorrow of the world produces death." You see, Orpah and Ruth, they both wept tears. They both proclaimed their loyalty to Naomi. "Naomi, we're never going to leave you." And they both wept. But Orpah was just, it was just all lip service. You know, she kissed Naomi, but Ruth hung on to her. You see, as a pastor, I do get to see people weeping over their sin, broken in their sin, crying out, "Oh, yeah, I'm going to live my life for Jesus." Here's the deal. True godly sorrow is being sorrowful because you've sinned against God. And that sorrow because you've sinned against God leads you to repent. The word repent means to change the mind. And as you change the mind, you change your life. So before I'm living in sin, I'm lying, and now I'm living for Jesus and I'm telling the truth. Before I was fornicating, living in lust, now I'm living in purity and righteousness. Every thought, every action, every deed. Before I was stealing, now I'm giving. Before I was hating, now I'm loving. I've changed my mind and I'm living my life for Jesus and I'm never turning back. I'm never turning back. See, worldly sorrow can lead to death. And as a youth pastor, I do get chances to minister to kids. And I'll kids will come to youth group and they're all bummed and I haven't seen them for a while. I'm like, "Hey, where you been?" "Well, I got busted for this and that. And I was doing drugs, or this happened, or that happened." And they're all bummed and they're all broken. And I ask them, "Are you bummed because you got busted? Or are you bummed because you sinned against the Lord?" Church, we can be bummed when we get busted in our sin. "Well, I got caught. I'm bummed now. I really feel bad that I got caught." But if you never got caught, would you still be continuing in your sin? Man, we need to be broken before God that we've sinned against Him. Amen? Because that sorrow that we've sinned against God, that'll lead to genuine repentance, which leads to salvation. You see, Ruth said, "Hey, wherever you go, Jesus, wherever you go, I'll go. Or wherever you go, Naomi, I'll go." Same with us. "Jesus, wherever you go, I'll go. Your people will be my people." You see, if a person says, "Well, I love Jesus, I just don't like going to church, I don't like Christians." Time out. We're going to be in heaven together forever. And if you say, "Well, I love Jesus, I just don't like Christians, I don't like going to church, I don't like being around other Christians." Ruth said, "Your people are my people. Wherever you go, I go. Where you're going to be buried, I will be buried. Until my dying day, until my dying breath, I will be with you." Look again, verse 17. "Where you die, I will die. Jesus, you died for me, and I'm going to die for you. I'm going to live my life for you till my dying breath. And there I will be buried. Thus may the Lord do to me and worse, if anything but death parts you and me." And the good news, my family, the good news about being a Christian is that for us as Christians, death is not the end. Death is not closing the door and is done. Death for us is the beginning. That's opening the door into future relationship with the Lord and eternity. Naomi, Ruth, "Oh, Naomi, I'm going to be with you as long as I live. The only thing that's going to separate me from you, Naomi, is death." But for us, when we make a decision for Jesus, even death doesn't separate us. And again, it's not how many tears we cry, it's how we walk with the Lord. Amen? Because You see people, forgive me, Jesus, and they're crying. That's awesome. That's awesome. But if we don't continue with the Lord, you just cried a bunch of tears and then went back to your gods. And that's what Orpah did. Well, verse 18, let's finish this chapter. Then she saw that she was determined to go with her. And she said to her, she said no more to her. Verse 19, so they both went until they came to Bethlehem. And it came about when they came to Bethlehem that all the city was stirred because of them. And the woman said, is this Naomi? Is this the pleasant one? Is this sunshine? Is this her? She'd been in the world for 10 years. She'd been in the toilet bowl, the garbage can, for 10 years. And I always enjoy Waxer's joke, because Waxer, you know, he looks kind of a young guy, but he's in his 40s, and people say to Waxer, Waxer, how come you look so young? Clean living. You know, if you're living a life of partying and smoking and drugs and this and that, it's going to take a toll on you. And you see some people, they're living lives of sin, and it's like they look old before their age. You know, they're 40 and they look like they're 60 or 80 or whatever it might be. And they're like, is this Naomi? The world had been tough on her. Well, verse 20, she said to them, do not call me Naomi, but call me Mara, which means bitter. For the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. And I would say, church, not really. Yes, Elimelech, my God is king, died. Yes, your sons have died. Yes, one of your daughter-in-laws left you. But it's not necessarily the Almighty God that has been harsh on you. The Lord, the Bible does say, Hebrews 12:6, that the Lord disciplines those whom he loves, and God will discipline us. But a lot of times that discipline will come in the form of the consequences of our own sin. The Bible says, don't be deceived. We reap what we sow. If we sow to the flesh, we're going to reap corruption. The Bible says our sin finds us out. It just boomerangs back on us. You know, if I go and I rob a bank, I can't be like, well, God's punishing me because now I'm in jail. No, it's my own sin boomeranged back on me, and now I got a prison ministry. You know, if a young man goes out and does a bunch of drugs and you destroy all your brain cells, or you drink a bunch of alcohol and you destroy your liver, you can't say, well, God's just punishing me. No, you have cirrhosis of the liver and no more brain cells because you destroyed them. You know, if you go out and you sleep around and you catch an STD and, you know, you get herpagona syphilids, you can't say, oh, God's punishing me. It's just the consequences of your sin. You sow to the flesh, you reap corruption. God loves us. Amen? God loves us. That's why he says, don't be deceived. Don't be tricked. Don't be fooled. If you sow to the flesh, you're going to reap corruption. So sow to the spirit and reap eternal life. Well, she says, don't call me Naomi. Call me bitter. Look at verse 21. She says, I went out full, but the Lord brought me back empty. Wow. I hope every single person, if you have a pen, underline that verse. I hope if you don't have a pen, you go home tonight, get a marker, and highlight that verse, church, because that's always what happens. We're in the house of the Lord, and man, we're so blessed, and we don't even realize how blessed we are, and maybe we go through dry times, or maybe for whatever reason, we're just not able to praise the Lord, and we think, oh, I'm going to go into the garbage can of the world. I'm going to go to the dark toilet of the world. And what always happens for us, and I can confess this happened to me, is that you realize how blessed and how full you are, were in the presence of the Lord. And you go to the world and man, it always takes away. It's been said, the sin of math is it adds to our sorrow. The sin of math will always subtract from our energy. The math of sin will always multiply our troubles and divide our loyalties. When we go to the world, we always end up empty-handed. It's never satisfying. It's like cotton candy, just gives you rotten teeth. He says, I went out full, but the Lord brought me back empty. She's like, why do you guys call me Naomi? Since the Lord has witnessed against me and the Almighty has afflicted me. Oh, I think the Lord would say, Naomi, I love you. And I have my thoughts towards you are thoughts of peace and not of evil, to bring you into a future and a hope. And if you're here tonight, my brother, my sister, and you kind of feel like, you know what, this is me. Instead of being in the house of bread where the manna's coming out, and the place of praise, you know what, I've kind of been going to the toilet bowl, the garbage can of the world, and it's just been empty. I believe that the Lord wants you to know that he loves you, that his plan for you is a plan of peace, that God has a future for you. God has a plan for your life. God has a hope for you. God loves you. God wants to bless you. He wants to protect you. And we're going to see the Lord is going to do an amazing miracle. The Lord is going to pour out so much grace upon Naomi and Ruth that at the end, all they can do is just worship and be amazed. You know, the Lord is able to restore the years that the locusts have eaten. And some of us, because of our own stubbornness, because of our own rebellion, we've invited in the locusts. And the locusts, the devil, our own sin and rebellion has destroyed. And I can tell you, I have whole years of my life that the devil stole from me. I have whole years of my life that were just wasted. And I was wasted. But I can tell you the truth that God is gracious and God is forgiving. And Jesus Christ can restore and bless and heal. You might be here tonight and you say, Mike, I've blown it. My marriage is suffering. The Lord, church, listen, the Lord can heal your marriage. You might be here tonight and think, man, I've been in the garbage can of the world and my children, it's affected my children. The Lord can restore the years the locusts have eaten. The Lord can bless, and he wants to bless. Come back to him tonight. My prayer, my honest prayer, church, is that every one of us, that we would turn our hearts to him. And we would say, Lord, I am yours, and I am here to worship you, and I want to walk with you all the days of my life. And not even death will separate me from you. Amen? Check out the last verse. It says, so Naomi returned with her and with Ruth the Moabitess and her daughter-in-law, who returned from the land of Moab. And they came to Bethlehem, it says, at the beginning of the barley harvest. Now, some of us might be like, well, big whoop-de-doo. The cool thing is, the beginning of the barley harvest, they had a holiday to commemorate the barley harvest. And that holiday was the holiday of Passover. During Passover, they would take a lamb and they would sacrifice the lambs for the sin, for the nation. They would confess their sin. They would turn to God. And Jesus Christ, those of us, if you know the Bible, Jesus Christ, our Passover lamb, the lamb who took away the sin of the world. Jesus, while they were sacrificing thousands of lambs on the day of Passover, Jesus himself, our lamb, was put on a cross and his blood was shed for us. And you and I, we might be here tonight and we might be like, you know what? I've kind of been in the garbage can. You know, I've kind of left the house of bread and I've been in the darkness. I've been in the perversity. I've been in Moab. But tonight I want to come back to the Lord. And the good news is Passover. When you come back, it's Passover. When we come back, we can come back to the Lord because of the cross. Amen? Because of his blood, we can come back to him. And he says, you're my son. You're my daughter. I have a plan for you. I'm going to bless you and use you. So church, as the brothers come forward and lead us in worship, I believe that God's desire is that every one of us say, Lord, I am yours. I am yours. And I want to stay in the house of bread, the land of praise, all the days of my life. Would you stand with me? Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for your word. Lord, we're here tonight because you're our King. Lord, we're here tonight because we have found that you are the pleasant one. We are sick, we're puny, we're nothing without you. Lord, we desire tonight to come to the cross, to worship you, to feast on the manna, your word. Lord, to be in the place of praise, the land of Judah. And so, Lord, I pray right now your Holy Spirit would draw us to you. That, Lord, as we worship, as we lift our hands, as we lift our heart, Lord, that you would draw us to you and you would draw close to us. So, Lord, be blessed. And we ask for your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.